From New York, this is Democracy Now!
We are currently on a pace to finish by August the 31st. The sooner we can finish, the better. Each day of operations brings added risk to our troops.
As President Biden vows, U.S. troops will meet its deadline to leave Afghanistan. We'll speak with Afghan journalist Bilal Sarwari, who reported on Afghanistan for 20 years before he fled Kabul to Doha on Sunday with his family, saying, in the city I loved, suddenly nowhere was safe.
I hope that I'm able. You know, and I hope that my daughter is able to basically one day go to school here. But there are things that are beyond my control. There are things that, you know, people like myself and my colleagues and other Afghans simply are powerless. We can't do that.
We'll also speak with longtime anti-war activist Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, then to Haiti, where the death toll from the massive August 14th earthquake has passed 2,200, with thousands of survivors growing increasingly desperate.
Our throats are dry because we are thirsty. We have no choice but to stay here. Children crying for water and food. We stay here because there is nothing else we can do.
We'll get an update from a Haitian doctor in Lake Cai near the epicenter and speak with a Haitian citizen journalist helping the BBC report on the forgotten villages cut off from help. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Biden says U.S. troops are on pace to leave Afghanistan by the August 31st deadline, despite pressure from allies in the G7 to stay longer to help more people flee the country. The United States has so far helped evacuate over 82,000 people from the Kabul airport, where there have been 19,000 evacuations in just the last 24 hours. President Biden spoke Tuesday.
We are currently on a pace to finish by August the 31st. The sooner we can finish, the better. Each day of operations brings added risk to our troops. But the completion by August 31st depends upon the Taliban continuing to cooperate and allow access to the airport.
Amnesty International criticized Biden's decision to halt evacuations after August 31st. The head of Amnesty's U.S. office, Paul O'Brien, said, quote, the U.S. government should continue to negotiate to proceed with evacuations for as long as necessary to evacuate all of the country's most vulnerable, he said. Meanwhile, it's become far harder for Afghans to reach the Kabul airport over the last 24 hours. The Taliban has blocked the main road to the airport and set up checkpoints to only allow passage to people with foreign passports or an invitation for the U.S. or one of its allies. At a press conference Tuesday, the Taliban said Afghans will no longer be allowed to go to the airport.
Unfortunately, this problem has not been resolved yet. The Islamic Emirate is seriously trying to control the situation there. We have blocked the way that people go to the airport by it. Afghans are not allowed to use this road, and foreign nationals can use it. But domestic nationals cannot go this way because it is blocked.
Despite the Taliban's warning, there are reports some Afghans are still making it to the airport. In other news in Afghanistan, the World Bank has joined the International Monetary Fund in cutting off funds for Afghanistan. This comes as aid groups are warning of a looming humanitarian catastrophe. The UN says 14 million Afghans, about a third of the country, are facing food insecurity. On Capitol Hill, the Democratic-led House has approved a $3.5 trillion budget resolution to vastly expand the social safety net and combat the climate emergency. Not a single Republican voted to move the process forward. In a deal to win support from conservative Democrats, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi agreed to set a September 27th deadline to vote on a separate bipartisan $1.2 trillion infrastructure bill. Many progressive lawmakers are demanding a vote on the $3.5 trillion plan prior to the bipartisan infrastructure deal. The House has also voted to pass the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act, which aims to restore key provisions of the 1965 Voting Rights Act that were gutted by the Supreme Court. Every Republican voted against the bill. The legislation is named after the civil rights icon John Lewis, who served in Congress for more than three decades. Georgia Congressmember Nikema Williams, who represents Lewis's former district, praised the legislation.
Congressman Lewis taught us that when you see something that is not fair, not just, not right, you have a moral obligation to find a way to get in the way. The voter suppression laws that have been enacted across the country and what is happening in my home state of Georgia is the very definition of the good trouble that John Lewis taught us to get into, to push back against. We might not be counting jelly beans in a jar, but make no mistake, they seek the same purpose, to stop people who look like me from accessing their right to vote.
In immigration news, the Supreme Court has revived the contested Trump-era Remain in Mexico program. Tuesday's ruling comes after a federal judge in Texas and Trump appointee last week ordered the Biden administration to reinstate the 2019 policy, formerly known as the Migrant Protection Protocols, or MPP. The program forced some 68,000 asylum seekers to wait in often extremely dangerous conditions in Mexico while their cases made their way through U.S. courts. Many reported kidnappings and facing brutal violence while waiting in Mexico. Immigrant justice advocates have vowed to continue fighting the policy. In related news, the group Human Rights First has tracked over 6,000 kidnappings, sexual assaults, and other brutal violence against asylum seekers who have been blocked from entering the United States at ports of entry or quickly expelled to Mexico since President Biden took office. The group's denouncing Biden's continued use of Title 42, a Trump-era policy that allows immigration authorities to expel asylum seekers without due process, citing the pandemic as justification. Meanwhile, social and environmental justice advocates are praising a federal judge's ruling, saying the Homeland Security Department and Customs and Border Protection broke the law by not properly looking into how increased militarization of the U.S.-Mexico border would harm the environment and wildlife. Monday's ruling comes after a 2017 lawsuit filed by Democratic Arizona Congressmember Raul Grijalva and the Center for Biological Diversity. The United States recorded 1,400 new COVID-19 deaths and 150,000 new cases Tuesday alone, as the highly contagious Delta variant continues to spread. Oregon has become the first state to reinstate an outdoor mask mandate in most public settings. Hawaii's governor is begging tourists to stay away as the state deals with a surge in COVID cases. Meanwhile, the American Medical Association's called for broad vaccine mandates. In a statement, the group said, quote, "Now's the time for the public and private sectors to come together, listen to the science, and mandate vaccination." And in New York, Kathy Hochul announced a new mask mandate in the schools in her first address as governor.
New York is launching a back-to-school COVID-19 testing program to make testing for students and staff widely available and convenient. I'm also immediately directing the Department of Health to institute universal masking for anyone entering our schools.
Vice President Kamala Harris has announced the United States will provide 1 million additional COVID vaccine doses to Vietnam. Harris made the announcement earlier today during a meeting in Hanoi with Vietnam's prime minister. On Tuesday, Cuba announced it, too, would send vaccines to Vietnam, in addition to sharing vaccine technology to help Vietnam make its own vaccines. In other vaccine news, Johnson & Johnson has revealed it has developed a booster shot that provides 9 times as many antibodies as its original vaccine on its own. A Minnesota appeals court has denied an appeal aimed at halting construction of the Enbridge Line 3 tar sands pipeline in northern Minnesota. In a 2-to-1 ruling, the court upheld Minnesota Public Utilities Commission's approval of the 340-mile-long pipeline. More than 700 people have been arrested since June in indigenous-led protests against the pipeline. Indigenous lawyer Tara Hauska of the Ginu Collective condemned Tuesday's ruling.
Today's ruling from the Minnesota Supreme Court is yet another example of Minnesota not responding to the climate crisis, not respecting Indigenous sovereignty, and continuing to ignore what's happening in real time all around us with smoky skies, the world burning, the rivers in drought, and water protectors being brutalized by police that are being paid by Enbridge.
In Brazil, thousands of Indigenous people marched on the capital in Brasilia Tuesday, protesting far-right President Jair Bolsonaro. Delegates from 140 Indigenous tribes have set up a week-long encampment in Brasilia to demand protection of their ancestral land and cultures. In Colombia, advocates are demanding justice for 27-year-old Esteban Mosquera, a student leader who was shot dead in his hometown of Popayan on Monday. Witnesses say two men on a motorcycle shot him near his home. In 2018, he lost an eye after Colombian riot police threw a stun grenade at him. He also participated in Colombia's recent massive anti-government protests and had reportedly been detained by police at least twice. The Inter-American Commission on Human Rights is urging the Colombian government to investigate Mosquera's assassination. So far this year, over 100 human rights defenders and community leaders have been killed in Colombia. Israeli forces have killed another Palestinian teenager in the occupied West Bank. On Tuesday, 15-year-old Imad Khaled Salah Hashash was shot in the head while standing on the roof of his home. At the time, he was reportedly attempting to use his phone to document Israeli troops raiding the Balata refugee camp near Nablus. Imad is the 12th Palestinian child killed by Israeli forces with live ammunition this year. This, according to the group Defense for Children Palestine. Meanwhile, Israel's new Prime Minister, Naftali Bennett, has arrived in Washington, where he'll meet with President Biden Thursday. In a new interview with the New York Times, Bennett ruled out reaching a peace agreement with the Palestinians, vowed to expand illegal Jewish settlements in the West Bank, and threatened to continue Israel's covert attacks on Iran. President Biden's approved a major disaster declaration for parts of Northern California to help areas devastated by the climate-fueled Dixie and River fires. Over 1.5 million acres of land have burned so far this year in California, and the number is growing as the Caldor Fire is less than 10% contained. It's now threatening communities near Lake Tahoe. Air quality alerts linked to smoke from the wildfires have been issued in 7 states: California, Nevada, Oregon, Colorado, Wyoming, Montana, and Idaho. Residents of Reno, Nevada are being urged to stay home with their windows closed because the air is so unsafe to breathe. Meanwhile, in Minnesota, more than 400 firefighters are battling a large blaze near the Canadian border. One official compared the Greenwood fire to a freight train, saying, quote, "Once it starts rolling, it starts to build up steam and feed off itself." 4 Black police groups, including the National Association of Blacks and Criminal Justice, are calling for former Black Panther Sundiata Okoli to be released from prison. The 84-year-old activist has been locked up for nearly half a century. Okoli was convicted of killing a state trooper on the New Jersey Turnpike in 1973. He has long said police ambushed his car, which was also carrying 2 fellow members of the Black Liberation Army, Zaid Malik Shakur, who was shot to death, and Asada Shakur. She was imprisoned over the incident, but later escaped to Cuba, where she has lived with political asylum. The Black police groups say Sundiata Okoli's continued imprisonment after more than 4 decades is, quote, an affront to racial justice. The former U.S.-backed dictator of Chad, Hissène Habré, has died in prison at the age of 79. In 2016, he was convicted of crimes against humanity and sentenced to life in prison. Habré was accused of killing as many as 40,000 people during his 8-year reign in the 80s after coming to power with help from the Reagan administration. The civil rights activist Lucille Times has died at the age of 100. She's been credited with inspiring the Montgomery bus boycott in Alabama, 6 months before a white bus driver in Montgomery ordered Rosa Parks be arrested for refusing to relinquish her seat to a white man. Lucille Times began her own boycott of the city's bus system after the same bus driver tried to run her car off the road. Lucille Times died from complications of COVID-19. And the sociologist, author, and educator James Loewen has died at the age of 79. He was the author of many books, including the bestseller Lies My Teacher Told Me, Everything Your American History Textbook Got Wrong. Loewen at once wrote, quote, "Telling the truth about the past helps cause justice in the present." And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We begin today's show in Afghanistan, where President Biden says U.S. troops are on pace to leave by the August 31st deadline, despite pressure from U.S. allies in the G7 to stay longer to help more people flee the country. The U.S. has helped evacuate over 82,000 people from the Kabul airport, Biden spoke Tuesday.
We are currently on a pace to finish by August the 31st. The sooner we can finish, the better. Each day of operations brings added risk to our troops. But the completion by August 31st depends upon the Taliban continuing to cooperate and allow access to the airport.
Amnesty International criticized Biden's decision to halt evacuations in the coming days. The head of Amnesty's U.S. office, Paul O'Brien, said, quote, "The U.S. government should continue to negotiate to proceed with evacuations for as long as necessary to evacuate all the country's most vulnerable," he said. Meanwhile, it's become far harder over the past 24 hours for Afghans to reach the Kabul airport. The Taliban has blocked the main road to the airport and set up checkpoints to only allow passage to people with foreign passports or an invitation from the U.S. or one of its allies. At a news conference on Tuesday, the Taliban said Afghans can no longer go to the airport.
Unfortunately, this problem has not been resolved yet. The Islamic Emirate is seriously trying to control the situation there. We have blocked the way that people go to the airport by it. Afghans are not allowed to use this road, and foreign nationals can use it. But domestic nationals cannot go this way because it is blocked.
This comes as aid groups are warning of a humanitarian catastrophe. The UN says 14 million Afghans, about a third of the country, face food insecurity. For more, we're joined by Bilal Sarwari, an Afghan journalist who was based in Kabul and reported on Afghanistan for 20 years before he fled for safety. This is Bilal speaking just last week on Democracy Now! About whether it was safe for him and his family to stay in Kabul.
I hope that I'm able, you know, and I hope that my daughter is able to basically one day go to school here. But there are things that are beyond my control. There are things that, you know, people like myself and my colleagues and other Afghans simply are powerless. We can't do that.
That was last Wednesday. On Sunday, Bilal tweeted, "The day I leave my country, my city, my Kabul. A massacre of my dreams and aspirations. A tragic day in my life." His latest piece for the BBC is headlined, "In the city I love, suddenly nowhere was safe." He's joining us now from Doha, Qatar. Bilal, welcome back to Democracy Now! Can you describe—talk about your decision to leave with your family, and then describe your journey from Kabul to the airport to where you are now in Doha, Qatar.
Extremely painful decision. All of a sudden, I had to leave my office, which was next door to my home, without being able to tell my sisters or family members where we were going. I took my parents, my wife, my baby daughter with me. We were hiding for a couple of nights. And then we headed towards the Hamid Karzai International Airport. And since I know this city so well, it's my hometown, it's my city, it's where I grew up. You know, I felt like nowhere was safe for me, as, you know, Taliban fighters and certain members of Taliban factions continued to knock on doors. I don't know why they were doing that, what exactly they wanted, and why did the Taliban political leadership fail to prevent such searches, you know, which are widespread across many different parts of the city. The only thing that I could really leave was a pair of clothes. And only 2 weeks ago, I had gone to the northern parts of Kabul city, speaking to people who were forced because of the war in Kunduz province and elsewhere in northern Afghanistan. And that at that moment that I was talking to them, I immediately went back to the 1990s when I was a kid and we were forced to leave Kabul because of the fighting. And I would never and ever thought that only 2 weeks later on, it will be my fate as well. So the fact that I could only pick up my own computer and a couple of iPhones and chargers and a pair of clothes and not knowing actually if we will make it into the airport and outside of Afghanistan was, I think, you know, a very, very painful period of time, especially for my family's sake, for my daughter's sake. But once I was on the plane, thanks to the Qatari government for evacuating close to 150 people alone on that flight, I could see everything that Afghanistan was over the last 20 years. I saw the country's most popular TV presenter. I saw the most famous woman who started every morning on Tullo's most popular show, Bamdadi Sob. And my wife recognized her. I could not immediately because she was covering her face. And, you know, you talked about burials of dreams as we spend, you know, like the next 12 hours all together. A lot of these are people that I know. There's an artist. His name is Sharifi. He was known as the Art Lord. He was painting a lot of these, you know, peaceful messages, anti-corruption messages on these glass walls on the streets of Kabul. He was there. And no matter what I did, you know, to not think about it, I thought, well, this is the tsunami, you know, of brain drains. This is Afghanistan going down the drain in a matter of seconds. And some people were crying, some were quiet, others just simply did not want to talk. And that literally, like, summed it up for me, you know, when I first arrived at the military airport, I think it really had a very, very negative impact on me because it was that location that over the years I traveled to across the country with senior Afghan military officials covering their operations. And coming back to it, you know, knowing that nothing exists anymore in Afghanistan's institutions, Afghanistan's national security forces, Afghanistan's air force, all crumbled, I think also hit me very hard.
So describe the scene at the airport before you got on that Qatari flight to Doha. What was it like to go through the checkpoint? Who checked your family's documents on the outside of the airport?
Well, we were very grateful to the dynamic Qatari ambassador who basically transported the convoy of 150 people, plus people, including some of the most important people in every aspect of the life, including media and civil society. And we went through the airport with the Taliban escorting the ambassador's motorcade in the front. Then we arrived to the last point where the Afghan forces, special forces who have been working with the Americans, were only 2 to 3 meters from the Taliban. There was what I would call a buffer zone. And once we got past that, you know, there was a sense of jubilation and happiness among families. There was a young, bright student from the American University of Afghanistan with her family. And I was just watching her cry as she was trying to record something on her smartphone. And I think it was at that moment as well that it hit me really, really hard. Because as a kid, I fled Kabul, not by air, by road. And I had never thought that, you know, let's say 30 years down the line, this will be a repeat, not only for me, but also for other generations. So it was a very, very painful moment. Once we were inside the airport, you know, the situation was more orderly than the previous days inside. There were more and more of these massive, you know, humongous military planes from Sweden, from Australia, you know, from Czech Republic. I saw a lot of them from Australia coming in and trying to you know, pick up Afghans as well as foreign nationals. Chinook helicopters were also flying over several directions into the city, assuming that they were airlifting people. But outside of the airport, the situation remains extremely miserable for thousands of Afghans, including women and children, and even more so for a generation of Afghans who feel that their lives are under threat if they leave their homes towards the airport, let alone people who are stuck in the provinces across the country. And this is, I think, the more painful reality, that those people continue to ask for a humanitarian corridor. They ask for safe passage. And every time you have an artificial timeline or you have a deadline that is announced, I think it is sending shockwaves among those people because they will be exposed, they will be vulnerable. And this is also the best of the best of the best of the educated generation that Afghanistan has. And the failure on the part of the previous government, Afghan politicians, as well as international community, not to preserve this generation, will have consequences for everyone in the years to come.
Can you talk also about the thousands that are fleeing over land, going over the Turkish border, trying to get into Iran? Reports are suggesting Turkey is closing its borders and turning away refugees. If you can talk about the responsibility of neighboring countries. So Turkey, of course, a close ally of the United States, may be running that airport after the U.S. leaves.
To be honest with you, I cannot comment on something that I don't know. I haven't heard that people can leave by land. I think there's a sense of fear and uncertainty. People are not feeling secure. I did hear that some people managed to cross into Pakistan via the Torkham crossing in the eastern province of Nangarhar, but very limited numbers. I think here we're talking about Afghans who have a history of working with the American military, the American government, and other Western and NATO nations. Their lives are at risk. They are the people who were told that they will be evacuated. And the remaining numbers are big. They are thousands and thousands of people, including people in the provinces who simply cannot come in. So this is, a sense of betrayal. Among these people, they know that they have, a massive threat against their lives by the Taliban. So we will have to see what happens to them if the evacuation ends, in the deadline that the American government has announced.
And what about the conditions in Doha? Thousands of Afghans have gone to Doha, also to Ramstein Air Force Base in Germany. Some of the media is reporting the conditions are getting worse and worse in Doha because of the numbers of people coming in. Is that your experience?
Well, we are both very lucky and grateful that the plane that we were in, we have been provided accommodation by the Qatari government. We've been looked after, and our families have been able to basically, relax at least for a bit. And I want to say this publicly. I want to thank the Qatari government, because the world should work with governments like Qatar, who has the ability on the ground to evacuate, people that we should be evacuating. This is, I think, where allies of the United States and other countries can come in and play that crucial role. I also feel that a lot of my friends and people that I know who I've been in contact with are quite confused. They're angry, they're disappointed, but they're confused because they hear different messaging. And now, this morning, someone was talking to me. She's a very prominent member of the civil society. She's outside of Kabul. She said the fact that she needs to take a bus to Kabul is out of the question, and she will not be able to go through the Taliban checkpoints into the airport. I think this is the crux of the issue at the moment, People want assurances that the West and the international community will evacuate for as long as it takes, that they will put sufficient pressure on the Taliban to allow the safe passage, because these people genuinely feel that their lives are at risk.
Bilal, in your article for the BBC, you write about the fall of the Taliban after the U.S. invasion in the fall of 2001. You say, "I saw a genuine willingness amongst the rank and file of the Taliban to lay down their arms and resume their lives. But the Americans didn't want that. From my reporting, it seemed to me and many other Afghans that their motivation was revenge after 9/11. We're coming up on the 20th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks. Can you talk about the peace moments lost when you actually had the Secretary of Defense under Bush, Rumsfeld, saying no to the Taliban, saying they would surrender if Mullah Mohammed Omar could remain living in dignity in Kandahar, and even the Taliban saying they would turn over before this Osama bin Laden?
I think in hindsight, when the Taliban government was toppled by the Americans at that time, their fighters and most of their mid-level commanders did go back, you know, to rural Afghanistan. They wanted to start their normal lives. There were raids, they were jailed, they were, you know, killed, mostly, you know, at the hands of warlords who were allies back then with the Americans. And there was a lot of family politics, tribal and clan rivalries. People wanted to settle old score, or people simply wanted to lie to the Americans so that they can get something back in return. And those mistakes would cost Afghanistan immensely. But it's also true that the Americans shut down the door on negotiations very earlier on, refusing President Karzai's request that such negotiations and back-channel talks must continue. We know that there were a lot of letters and communications at the highest echelons of the Taliban leadership with the former Afghan President Hamid Karzai and other elements of the government at that time. Obviously, the other mistake was also the fact that the leadership went back to Pakistan, where they got help from the Pakistani intelligence services and the Pakistani army, institutional support, something that has been well documented. And on the ground, the Afghan government literally failed to curb corruption, injustice, provide basic services. You know, the Afghan government was seen as a milking cow, you know, among these various powerful figures where government positions were handed over as trophies. So I think when you think about that and the U.S. decision at the time to invade Iraq, the hijacking of resources, I think all of those mistakes, all of those, you know, policies at the time contributed towards, you know, the bigger problem. And I would also say that the Taliban over the years had this feeling, this very prevalent feeling among their leaders and commanders that they can win militarily. When they found out that the Americans were withdrawing, the announcement in the absence of a peace process or a comprehensive ceasefire, it was just a matter of time before the Taliban would take over. But no one thought this quick. And I also think that a 9/11 style commission report must be launched to find out what led to the crumbling of state institutions in Afghanistan, to the billions of dollars worth of sensitive military equipment that the Taliban now control. Because after all, this is taxpayers' money from many of these countries invested. And I would also cite a personal example where I lived in a very central part of Kabul. My next door neighbor appeared as a neighbor. We had a good relationship with them. We were on friendly terms. After the fall of Kabul, it was very clear to us that that was the Taliban's intelligence operations. In a street that was home to special forces commanders, former interior minister, the head of the defense committee at the Afghan parliament, and a number of intelligence chiefs across many provinces. So you are also talking about a massive intelligence failure that should go back to a few years when Taliban were able to, for example, recruit university students who had a job at the central part of Kabul in a bank. I knew a guard and I knew a bank employee over the years. I would go and talk to them. And the fact that the Taliban were able to recruit, you know, right into the heart of the Afghan capital right under the eyes of the Afghan intelligence service, I think also shows you that this is a massive process of failures, the responsibility of which, with the Afghan government, with the Afghan institutions and leadership, and how could have they, like, failed, the people of Afghanistan on so many levels.
Finally, Bilal, we just have 30 seconds. Should President Biden pull out all U.S. troops and end evacuations on the 31st? The Taliban are insisting on this, though it was a U.S.-set deadline. But the U.S. government is also saying they are most concerned about terrorist attacks, not from Taliban, but from Taliban's enemies, ISIS-K and al-Qaeda.
The Americans must honor the promises that they have made to people. This is about human lives. This is about a generation of Afghans. And I don't think anyone would want such massacres and such tragedies to be a stain on their legacy and on their government.
I want to thank you so much for being with us, Bilal Sarwari, Afghan journalist based in Kabul, who's reported on Afghanistan for 20 years. We'll link to his BBC piece, "In the City I Love, Suddenly Nowhere Was Safe." We spoke to him last week in Kabul. Now he has fled with his family to Doha, Qatar. This is Democracy Now! We continue to look at the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan and the ending of America's longest war with leading anti-war activist Madiha Benjamin. Stay with us. Stones. The Stones drummer, Charlie Watts, died Tuesday at the age of 80. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we continue to look at the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan and the ending of America's longest war with leading anti-war activist Madiha Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink. For decades, she's been dragged out of congressional hearings, presidential speeches, political conventions by security, as she and others have called for peace. President Biden wants to end evacuations in Afghanistan by the August 31st deadline, but faces pressure to stay longer. Madiha, if you can start there to talk about your response to the focus of all the media on what is absolutely the chaos and catastrophe at this point in Kabul for so many Afghans. But you have always widened the lens. For decades, you have been protesting the U.S. war in Afghanistan. Is this how you think it should end?
Of course, we didn't want it to end like this, and there should have been better planning in terms of getting people out of the country. But we were very clear we never wanted the U.S. to go in to begin with, and every single year we kept saying, get out. It was fascinating listening to Bilal and him talking about all of the corruption inside Afghanistan. And I just kept thinking of this cash cow that has been the war in Afghanistan that we have been fighting against all these years. We also got dragged out of meetings of shareholder from Halliburton to General Dynamics to think of all the companies that profited from this war and how they have been the ones who have kept the war going by putting their money into lobby groups. You just look at General Dynamics, Boeing, Raytheon, and their spending of $34 million in this year alone on lobbying our government. We have to find a way, Amy, that we reflect on what happened over these 20 years and look at these contractors that provide all of the logistics and have privatized the U.S. military. In fact, we have had more U.S. contractors in Afghanistan at many times during these 20 years than U.S. soldiers. So I think there's a lot of reckoning to be done, and I hope that we will be able, once this phase is over, which is chaotic and horrific, we will be able to look at who actually profited, where did all this money go, why did it happen, and how are we going to stop it from happening again?
So Afghanistan is something like $1 trillion worth of minerals, and there is a global fight now for countries to position themselves. You have been warning about the U.S. beefing up their anti-China rhetoric. Something that's not getting a lot of attention right now is Vice President Harris is on a South Asian trip. She was just in Singapore. Then she flew to Vietnam. She has warned about China in the South China Sea. Can you talk about the U.S.-China brinksmanship that's going on right now?
The tragedy is that the U.S. leaving Afghanistan for the Biden administration is a chance to focus on what they call our main adversary, which is China. It justifies this continual gargantuan Pentagon budget that eats up so much of our resources. And it is a delusional idea that we should be focusing on China as an enemy. It's a country of over 1 billion people. It's a nuclear country, especially at a time when we need to work with China to deal with issues like the climate, like the pandemic, like global poverty. China is going into Afghanistan and will work with the new Afghan government to build up the infrastructure. Well, where is all that infrastructure that the U.S. didn't do for the last 20 years? Why have they left Afghanistan, having been occupied by one of the richest countries in the world, us, the United States, to be one of the most impoverished countries in the world? The U.S. should actually learn from China that instead of going into countries with bombs and bullets, it should go into countries to figure out how to help build the infrastructure and build the economy that would be a win-win situation.
What do you feel the U.S. owes to the people of Afghanistan?
We feel that the U.S. owes a tremendous responsibility, not only for getting the Afghans out, as we're trying to do now, but for the millions of Afghans who are left behind in terrible, dire situations from this 20 years of war. You had a great program on yesterday, Amy, about the humanitarian crisis. Well, we feel like the U.S. is now going to use its economic warfare against Afghanistan to increase that humanitarian crisis by withholding $9 billion that belongs to Afghanistan in U.S. banks, by working with other countries in Europe and the IMF to withhold funding. We don't have to be friends with the Taliban, but we can't be the enemies either, because the victims will be the Afghan people. We need to let go of their funds. We need to provide generous humanitarian support. In fact, the U.S. should fund the entire $350 million urgent request made by the UNHCR, the refugee agency, because that's equivalent to just 1.5 days of war in Afghanistan. So we owe a lot to the people whose lives that we have helped destroy over these last 20 years.
As the battles rage in Congress over spending, I mean, you've got the massive infrastructure bill that the House just passed, the framework of $3.5 trillion. But there's also the Pentagon budget. Can you end there by talking about what you think needs to happen and the lessons of Afghanistan?
This is exactly where we need to go as a people in the United States to say that this epic failure in Afghanistan shows us that militarism is not the right way to respond to problems, that we have to cut the Pentagon budget in half, like Barbara Lee has suggested, freeing up $350 billion to be used to confront the real crisis of climate, of poverty, the infrastructure that we need, and to help countries around the world and our own country to deal with the pandemic and to get us a decent healthcare system. And I encourage all of the supporters of Democracy Now! To join us in this call to say to all our members of Congress and to the White House, cut the military budget in half. That is the most responsible way to respond to this tragedy of 20 years of colossal failure in Afghanistan.
Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, the author of a number of books, including Drone Warfare, Killing by Remote Control. When we come back, we go to Haiti, where the death toll from the massive earthquake has passed 2,200. Thousands of survivors growing increasingly desperate. Stay with us.
No more village. Tendrement dans mon village, cinq tout petits enfants, cinq orphelins d'ici de là qui s'ennuyaient seuls ici bas, et j'ai voulu qu'ils soient choyés dans un foyer. Dans mon village, tous cinq ils m'aimeront. Dans mon village, tous cinq ils grandiront. Et comme moi, je sais qu'un jour...
Dans mon village, by Josephine Baker, In My Village. Josephine Baker, the U.S.-born French performer, who will be given a memorial in Paris's Pantheon Mausoleum, making Baker the first woman to receive that honor. Her induction into the Pantheon will take place in November. She left the United States for France, protesting racism. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman as we end today's show in Haiti, where the death toll from the massive August 14th earthquake has passed 2,200, with thousands of survivors growing increasingly desperate. Over 12,000 were injured, estimated 53,000 homes destroyed by the 7.2 magnitude quake. People left homeless have been living in squalid camps in the mountains north of the hard-hit city of Lekai, where they say children are suffering from hunger, fevers, and infections.
We are here with our children. I don't know how many, but we need to feed them. We need food, water, dress. They are crying because they are hungry and thirsty. We need medication. And now we use this place as a shelter. Then we really need help to feed our children ourselves.
UNICEF says 1.2 million people were affected by the earthquake, including over 500,000 children. Humanitarian aid workers say shipments are now flowing into Haiti's southwestern peninsula, but there are still shortage of urgently needed food and medical supplies, as Haiti's also facing an economic crisis made worse by the pandemic. The assassination of President Jovenel Moïse, July 7th, has pushed the country into further political uncertainty. For more, we go to Haiti, where we're joined in Lekai, not far from the quake's epicenter, by Dr. Cherie-Marie Anlis, a general practitioner. Her family's originally from Camp Perrin, where most of them lost their homes during the quake. And in Port-au-Prince, we're joined by Stéphane Vincent. He is a citizen journalist covering the aftermath of the earthquake for BBC in a piece headlined, "The Forgotten Villages Cut Off from Help." We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Dr. Cherie, let's begin with you. Describe what is happening. You are right near the epicenter. You are a general practitioner in Lekai, so hard hit by COVID. You've been dealing with COVID patients. Now you've got the earthquake.
Good morning, ma'am. So, yes, I am Dr. Cherie Miranis. Where I am now, I am in Lekai, so where the earthquake is happening, I was inside my house with my baby running out and be hit by my car against a wall and fell down in the ground. And I have injury. So I can see all my neighbors has panic. Everyone has panic, is panicking. So this morning, as you can see, at 6 53 a.m., we had another replica. So all the people who were trying to sleep inside the house, they went out and been panicking. So you can ask the question again, please.
Just tell us, what are the greatest needs and the injuries that you're treating? Are you getting enough medical supplies? And do you have enough doctors and medical staff to help with those who are injured?
So we need, we are a lack of doctor. So in Lekai, especially, we have not enough doctor to care of the patient in pediatry, area, and back in the back place of the country. So we need doctor. People need food, they need water, they need clothes, okay? So many of them have infection wounds, so they don't have anyone to care of them where they are. So I can even see people trying to drink the rainwater during the earthquake.
And your family, can you describe what's happened to your own family as you try to help others?
Okay, so my own family, they are living at Camp Pere, so where my grandma's house fell down completely, and I have most of them lost their house. Me and my little baby has injured because of we were running out and hit by my car against the wall and fall in the ground. I have injury, so they are in need. They don't have house to sleep. They are out. They don't have tent to during the at night, and when it's raining, they don't have nowhere inside to stay where they are during the wind, okay? So they need food, they need clothes, they need medication in the hospital, too.
Finally, are you concerned about other infections breaking out? And is COVID getting worse, the people you were treating before the earthquake, because of the vulnerability of the population right now?
You know, Haitian people go to see doctor when they are dying, okay? So they try to make some tea, okay, to feel better at home. So when, if they feel they are dying, they go to see doctor. So where I am working now at sanatorium in Lekai with COVID-19 patients, I don't really receive a lot of people to be inside the hospital, hospitalized, I can say that too. To be hospitalized, okay? So I find people who is sick, and I give them medication and advice to go at their house, okay, in quarantine. So fortunately, I don't receive a lot of COVID-19 patients.
Well, I want to thank you so much, Dr. Cherie-Marie Anlis, for joining us, general practitioner in Lekai, which is right near the epicenter of the earthquake. We're going to go now to Port-au-Prince, where we're joined by the Haitian citizen journalist Stéphane Vincent. You co-wrote a piece for the BBC headlined, "The Forgotten Villages Cut Off from Help." You have made your way from the epicenter to the capital, Port-au-Prince, Stéphane. Can you describe what you've been seeing?
Good morning, Amy. Thank you for having me here. I've been back in Port-au-Prince for the past 48 hours. We went to Lekai. I, along the BBC News team, on Monday, we flew because at first it wasn't safe to drive to Lekai, which is about—Lekai is about a three-hour drive from the capital of Port-au-Prince. So we hopped on a flight for about 30 minutes to get to the epicenter of the earthquake. And upon arrival, it was disastrous to see, especially for me, having survived the 2010 earthquake. It sort of brought back all the emotional and mental sequels to sort of live that again. I mean, there are certain disasters you go through. You think you'd go through them once in a lifetime. So to relive that again was very heart-wrenching. And so far, we've gone around the South, whether it be the main city of Lekai or the other communes around the department. And the main observation has been that, as opposed to what many people may believe, the city of Lekai hasn't been as destroyed as we may think. I mean, we would say that out of six, seven houses, you'd find one that's been destroyed. However, the major impact is in the what we call the communal sections, which are small villages and towns in the outskirts of Lekai, where you would find a good 95, 96% rate of destruction. You literally drive around villages for 10, 20, 30 minutes, and you'd only see collapsed homes, churches, schools, you know, different types of buildings. And the people right now, the people in the city of Lekai or the communes have mostly been receiving help. However, the help gets stuck in these main areas, and the people most affected in the outskirts of the South haven't been receiving help. And this has been the case for several reasons. First of all, the people that come to give help, they come based on what they get from the news, and so they rush to the main towns and the main cities to help. And secondly, we've had Hurricane Grace, and because of the hurricane, rivers came down and cut off some of these villages from the main towns and the main cities. So cars, aid hasn't been able to be driven to these people. You had cases where at first there would be a group of young people who are able to swim. They would carry over the water a little bit of aid, but that hasn't been sufficient.
You quote someone in your piece, Stefan, saying, "Do I have to scream to get the government's attention, or are we being left to die?" If you can also compare this to what happened, I mean, the earthquake obviously was far worse in 2010. You're a survivor of that earthquake. I remember covering President Clinton in Port-au-Prince as he said, "The most important things to me now are my daughter's wedding and the recovery of Haiti." And yet, what actually happened now is you have many people who are still suffering from that earthquake dealing with this.
Yes, that statement that I quoted in the BBC piece was a statement made by this lady called Margaret Maurice in this area called Marceline. So Marceline is a little village out in Campeguen where the previous doctor we spoke to, her family, is from. And Marceline has been one of the hardest hit areas of the South. And throughout the entire greater South, whether it be in the NIPS department in the South, in the South, or even in the Governor's Department, the theme is recurrent. The people have been feeling left out and abandoned by government. I remember the following day after the passing of Hurricane Grace, we went to visit a camp in Lekai, Mlem de Gabion, and you had these people that were telling us that they spent the night sleeping, standing up, because it was raining, they had heavy winds, and they felt as though they've been left by the government. And one interesting thing that happened is that we can make this contrast. The government has decided to centralize aid to avoid what happened in 2010, to ensure an equitable distribution of aid. But on the other hand, the population that's on the ground suffering, they're saying, no, we don't want help to go through government because we don't want them to take the aid and do whatever they want with it. Give it to their own people. We want the organizations that are helping to come and give us the aid directly. That's one thing. And the second observation
was that— We have 20 seconds, Stefan.
Yes, in contrast to 2010, there has been little international presence. Haitians have really been getting help from other local organizations. It's mostly been a thing where brothers and sisters are helping each other so far. So the focus needs to be put on the outskirts of the South Department.
Stefan Vincent, I want to thank you so much for being with us,
yes.
A Haitian citizen journalist helping to cover the Haiti earthquake for the BBC. We'll link to your piece, "The Forgotten Villages Cut Off from Help." I'm Amy Goodman. Stay safe.